beginning, isn't it, for the next one? Oh, hello again. This is Richard Herring here. I'm doing a Leicester Square Theatre podcast here at the Leicester Square Theatre with David Cross. I mean, that's pretty exciting, isn't it? If you enjoy these, please go and buy a badge at gofasterstripe.com/badges, either monthly or one-off. If you do a monthly one, you get access to a free channel. You get entry into a prize draw with amazing prizes. And you also get a secret email, lots of other stuff. You can buy stuff like this at gofasterstripe.com, which will also help fund this. Or go to richherring.com/gigs and see if I'm playing live near you doing some prepared comedy, not just this made-up rubbish. I'm really good. You should come and see me. My new show is called The Best. It's my best of. If you don't like that, you're really not going to like anything. Anyway, let's see a proper comedian now. It's TV's David Cross. So, welcome to the Leicester Square Theatre. Please welcome a man who is the lifetime president of the Shipwreck Museum in Charlestown. It's Richard Herring! Hello! You were much better than last week's audience. Just you. So, welcome to the show. It's called Richard Herring's Leicester Square Theatre Podcast. I was down at the Rubik's Cube Championship. Rubik's Cube Championship. And the kid who could do it the quickest, he did it in like 2 seconds. He said he loved Rahulastapa. That was that's what he called the show. And so I will just have a look at some. We'll go over to some of the misfits over here. My iPad here. These gentlemen look. I mean, you look like two football fans who've walked in thinking, oh, there's something going on down there. I wonder. I've been waiting a long time for the second half of the. I guess it's been a week since they started this game. I wonder what the result. Don't like football. You're incapable. Yeah, okay. That's why you came here. What's your name, sir? The quiet one. Dave? Yeah. I'd have guessed that if I'd had to guess. Let's start. Hey, Dave. Yeah. I'm going to cut the other bit out. If you had to have sex with one of the Muppets, which Muppet would you have sex with, Dave?
Gonzo.
It's also a style of shooting pornography, so that is that's an excellent answer. What's your name, sir?
Darren.
What's your relationship with Dave, Darren?
I love her.
Are you? That's a horrific thought. You dress very similarly. I mean, I love homosexuality. Just the two of you. It's just a horrific picture. Are you the top or the bottom, Darren? Your side. Wound fetish. Good. Yeah, I can go worse than anyone in this audience, don't you? Don't worry. Look at them all there. Look, they're all excited. They hate football. They hate their country. They're all voting Remain. Anyone? Is there anyone voting Exit? Who's voting Exit? Anyone? Cheer if you're voting Exit. Not a single one. So Nigel Farage, who by the time this goes out is the Prime Minister, have these people hunted down. And have them killed. Well, that's very good. So that's 100% for Remain in here. Yeah, people are too embarrassed of their fascistic leanings to. Never mind. I'm going to move straight on because we've got a fantastic guest who's much more amusing than me. He is probably best known as Dog 2 in Doctor Doolittle 2. I think everyone agrees is the superior. Doctor Doolittle film and the superior of the two dogs. It's David Cross, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, that is magic. We did that for you, David. Thank you very much. Welcome. We've got more drink for you. Pull up a microphone. How did you do that?
When I said I would do this. Yeah. I flew in a week early and waited until about it was roughly 4 a.m.
Yeah.
And snuck in. It took me a little while. I had to case the place out, figure out the best entrance exit. You know, when the alarms go out, I had to, and came in and realized what I was going to have to do, where I was going to put this stuff. Then I had to go to the best place for this stuff to get it in bulk, and for me bulk is four. is in Sheffield, so I had to go up to Sheffield, talk to this guy. I didn't want to like say exactly what it was for, obviously. Then you know somebody would come in and go, oh fuck that guy, and taking it out. So went up to Sheffield, got these, and then and I said, will it stick to my forehead with just a little bit of saliva? And he was like, yeah. And spent a day up there in the factory where they make these, ensuring that I could get the right ones, that they would stick. They would, what are the logistically? How's it going to float down? What is the speed? What is the trajectory? I need the trajectory to be.
And like several people have walked across here, and it's amazing. So that was people who are listening on audio are confused. So what do you?
That is, they're very confused. That's a full 2 minutes where they have no idea where people are. I love it. Don't change it.
I think you've just gone insane. What do you remember?
You know what you should do is just underneath it.
Yeah.
Because this doesn't go out for a couple
weeks.
That's right. Is you get on there and they go, what's happening now is a bit of. What would we call that?
Is this an impression
perfetti.
Of me, David?
No, it's not.
This is like one of my impressions.
This is you doing a character
okay.
that doesn't have a. It has a questionable English accent.
What's happening now is a bit of confetti.
That sound like me. What do you remember about Doctor Doolittle 2?
What don't I remember? I remember. It's kind of similar to the story I just told. I'm very Meisner in my approach to acting. Stanislavski Meisner, Grotowski, the theater of the physical, and what was was initially voice. You know, I'm applying a voice to what was it? A dog? I don't know. So I would have to dog number two.
Yeah.
This is Doctor Doolittle two, right?
Yeah, Doctor Doolittle two.
I did both of them, and I think a marmoset or something in the first. I don't remember, but so I lived with a family of dogs for a year. They were Mongolian sheep herding dogs. Which I had, and it was at great cost to me. I mean, because I'm not stupid. I'm not going to go to Mongolia and live for a year. So I had to have the entire, I had to replicate the Mongolian, farmland. And so I had that set up in a place. It's Palmdale, California. It's kind of a desert. We had to bring in cooling systems for it was about a 19 square mile radius and replicate the Mongolian and then bring them in and bring in people because I don't speak I don't know what the language of Mongolia is.
No,
I would assume it's some sort of Russian Chinese hybrid kind of thing, and I don't speak that, so I had to bring in people because I wanted the dogs to be able to understand me. And I knew the dogs wouldn't speak English, and so I brought in people who could translate for the dogs. And then, and by the time I got all of that logistically in place, that took months and months and months because of visas and everything. This is shortly after 9/11, so it was like real. It was very tough security-wise, and it really only left me with about. Like 9 weeks to study, and that's not enough. So I asked, the studio, could they postpone? All right, that's enough. That is enough.
Very good. You lived for a while in Roswell, but not the interesting Roswell.
No.
Roswell in Georgia.
Yeah.
Shame it's in New Mexico. We could have talked about that for ages. But
you probably couldn't because, as I understand it, Area 51 has no access. So right. It would just be stories of like, yeah, I got up to the perimeter and
if you lived out. If you lived in Roswell, you would see things. So. And occasionally an alien would come down from the Area 51 to do some shopping.
Well, I mean, there's got to be one of the aliens who are there who really wants to... First of all, they're aliens, so they got to be a superior intellect, right? To Americans? Come on. Come on. They'd have to be massively more intelligent than the Americans currently in New Mexico. And you'd think somebody would just figure out a way to get out of there and get the story out.
You would. Yeah. But did you go to Barrington Hall much in Roswell, Georgia?
I don't know what that is.
What? Did you go to the teaching museum?
Book.
Did you go to the teaching museum north that didn't open until 1991? So you probably weren't there at the time.
No, I was gone by then. Yeah. I was in Boston.
Would you consider going back to Roswell to visit the teaching museum? It's a museum of all the teaching in the North Georgia area, I think.
If there is a museum
dedicated
to teaching.
Yeah.
In Georgia, then that is a one-room schoolhouse. Look, I'm a product of public education, and it's not good. I can barely spell. I can't. It's embarrassing, and I blame society.
All right. So you're partly English. You've got English blood within you. Your dad's from Yorkshire, as I am. So that's a good thing. And drinking bitter.
Yeah, yeah.
You're quite an Anglophile. That isn't a bad thing. The file suffix has been ruined. It's a very positive thing, generally. So you love England. You've lived in England on and off for quite a while.
I do. I absolutely love it here, and my wife does as well. And I haven't spent too much time outside of London, and I need to spend more.
There's nothing else anywhere else.
I was just in Manchester for the second time last night, and I loved it there. And and I'll be going to Leeds. I was in Leeds once for some ill-conceived idea of discovering my roots. Yeah. It was not a thought-out or wise... in fact, it's really... just to preface this, my father and his entire family came over to the States, like on the boat. He was the youngest of five kids, and a whole bunch of people came over. And he was like 14 or 15 at the time. And I'm estranged from him. He's a prick. He's a fucking asshole. And no, I'm not casting aspersions on Yorkshire. But he's a piece of shit. And I've been estranged from him for quite a while. But and my sister and I have a couple sisters, but we're the sister I'm close with. I was here. There was like a 3-day weekend, I think a bank holiday. Everybody who was working on the show I was working on was off with their families, and I was like, oh, I'll take this opportunity to go to Leeds. It was not thought out at all. I don't know what I was thinking, but I got off the train and I called my sister. And I'm like, hey, you're never gonna guess where I am. She's like, where? And she knew I was in London. I was like, I'm in Leeds. And she went, why? and then I was like, I don't know. I thought maybe I'd feel a presence or a thing. Would I go, this is who I am, you know? But that actually occurred when I first came to England for the very first time back in the 90s. And that was a very visceral, vivid feeling that I can still remember and recall of understanding so much about me when I was here, for the first time. There's part of it was romanticizing it, and as you said, I'm an Anglophile, and I grew up worshiping, you know, Monty Python and The Who and just all different aspects of British culture. And my birthday dinner was always fish and chips, for real. And I love that shit, and I love the rain and all. And I got here. I'm not kidding. And I grew up in a place that was wildly different from that, which I also never felt in tune with or a part of. And it was one of those things. I walked into a pub and it was raining and it was shitty. And I was in it was a dumb show it was over here for, and there was no budget. It was a shithole little piece of, it was awful motel thing, hotel. And
all of Leeds is like that, to be fair. So that's.
And I just remember, I remember ordering a pint and sitting there and wet and somewhat miserable and going, oh, I get it now. And it's still who I am in part. I'm quite comfortable in depressing, gloomy, situations. And so yeah, and I'm an alcoholic.
that's a difficult thing to imagine coming back and seeing in a completely different environment and country, but also from a parent that you're not close to at all as well. So your mother's American, or
yes,
yeah. So yeah. What a brilliant interviewer I am. That was the bit I should have put under the explaining. For people who didn't understand what just happened, I'll just sum that up. You mentioned Missed the Show. It's kind of interesting because I think probably a lot of people, British people, I kind of became aware of you via Arrested Development, which, absolutely. It was one of those shows that the first time I saw it, I couldn't understand what was going on at all. I think I dipped into the middle. Mm-hmm. And nearly all my favourite comedy shows, I thought, I don't like this. And then I watched it and went, oh no, I really like this. I think it's genuinely top three sitcoms of all time for me. It's an amazing show. But you've been doing stuff...
Big Bang Theory.
That's very good.
Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. Oh, and then Friends.
I would say Community, which you've also been in.
I fucking love Community.
Yeah.
Love Community. I have such a deep appreciation for specifically the writing on that show. I think everything about it is great, but I can just see, I know how hard it is to write, and people who don't write, and I don't mean this to sound condescending at all, but people who don't do that do not understand, don't have an appreciation in a more marked way than people who don't act, don't have an appreciation for acting or directing or any of those other things.
Sure.
If you don't know how difficult it is to have nothing and then to write something that makes sense, that has different characters and you tell a story and the things you don't put in, it's really hard to do. And I think Community is just tremendous writing.
Yeah, well, it really. I mean, because it's all the characters nearly always have something to do every week, and it's because
and it's like, about something.
Yeah,
there's
yeah.
There's a heart to it. There's a meaning to it, and it walks the line of being absurdist and crazy and silly, but it's grounded enough, just enough. I really dig the writing on that show.
Yeah, well, and also the other thing that I'm obsessed with at the moment is Rick and Morty, which you've also been in.
Yeah, that I haven't seen.
You've not seen it?
I know people love it. I know people love it a lot.
It's awesome.
Yeah. I did that because Dan Harmon was like, do you want it? I was like, I worship Dan Harmon.
Sure.
And I think he's amazing. And I just said, yeah.
Yeah.
Whatever you want me to do. So.
But you've worked with a lot of these guys who are the big American guys. Again,
just Dan Harmon.
Well, Dan Harmon. I mean, I don't really know much about Dan Harmon beyond his work, and that he might be a little bit difficult to work with sometimes, or just he's very driven by his work.
Well, that's certainly the rep, and I understand that he's a very specific. I don't think he's made for Hollywood.
No,
but that's what he does. That's where you have to do it.
Yeah.
So
but you've worked with Judd Apatow early on.
Mm-hmm.
And Michael Hurwitz, of course, in Arrested Development.
Mitch Hurwitz, yeah.
Mitch Hurwitz, sorry, I'm just an idiot.
Michael's his brother, and he was a grip on the show.
Yeah, that's right. That's what I was thinking.
A lot of people make that mistake, Richard.
But, You started, well, this is the thing that I've become aware of just because of the internet and social media, that you'll suddenly get sent a sketch from Mr. Show, which is your sort of mid-90s sketch show.
Right.
Which was on HBO.
It was no sort of about it.
It was, definitely. Yeah, it was. And so you get these amazing sketches about, you know, I think the first one I saw was the one with the thimble collection where...
Oh, yeah, yeah. The story of Everest.
And then there's the one of you being... the pre-recorded show. That's very good. But how did you get to the stage where you were doing that? So that was mid-90s. You started in stand-up or in doing sketch shows in clubs?
Yes, I started doing stand-up. And I was a real fuck-up for a long time. I mean, I was very, very happy due to a mixture of irresponsibility and kind of a fear of success and not wanting to really, you know, in this very, as I look back, you know, silly, pretentious idea of like, I don't want to go to Hollywood, I don't want to do that shit, I want to be pure and, you know, whatever, that I truly felt those things and I wanted my stand-up to be, you know, honest and so I was doing stand-up and then I had a sketch group that was in Boston that would specifically come out of open mic nights. Mm-hmm. That's how it started for like 2 years, where we'd have fake, it was really well thought out. We'd have plants in the audience, we'd have fake people who were, we had them wait in line with all the other people who were waiting in line to do stand up. And so the audience would never suspect that these people were, you know, fakes. And then it would just, before they knew it, there would only be like three comics that would go up. I would host the show, and then it would just turn into our sketch show, and nobody knew it for a year, you know, until we got kind of notorious for that and people understood what was happening. But it was a great, cool thing to do. And then I had written sketches in that group, and then a very close friend of mine, Jeannie Garofalo, who was a stand-up at the time, one of my friends, still a friend, Peter, went out to L.A., got on the Stiller show, Ben Stiller show, and then had me send some of those sketches there, and that's how I got into that.
Because there was it's an amazing group of people you've worked with early on who've all gone on in different ways, like at different levels, but you would, you know, you recognize all those guys from Mr. Show.
It was an incredible time. It was a really... we didn't really know it at the time, but it was really pretty radical, you know.
I was also in a mid-90s sketch show here in the UK.
Give me 1 second? Was it any good? Was it? Okay, that didn't seem very enthusiastic.
It's an honest appraisal. There's similarities, I think, between Mr. Show and Fist of Fun in terms of in the enjoyment of pedantry, I think is probably, you know, it's what I love about it. And subsequently, which I want to get onto, the new show you're doing with Bob, but it's of taking an idea and stretching it and testing patience, and it's quite different than a lot of more traditional sketches that say Saturday Night Live, which is what we're seeing of America and sketch shows over here. What's interesting in the net is that with Netflix, you've got back with Bob Odenkirk and are doing. And how many episodes? I've watched 3 episodes of it. Is that have I nearly got to the end of the?
Yeah, you're 3/4 of the way through.
I've got one more to look forward to.
You got one more, and then there's like a behind the scenes thing, but that's not really.
George, the incompetent sound guy, who said, "Oh, you've got to watch this before," and it was obviously I wouldn't anyway. But he said he watched the documentary and he watched 20 minutes before he realised it wasn't going to be a new show.
It wasn't a sketch. that's the best part of it. If you don't watch it in any new order and you watch that first, you're like, it's really dry. It's very esoteric. It's kind of ballsy. Yeah.
But I think what's quite interesting is you don't see many. If I may call you as I am a middle-aged man doing sketches anymore.
I hope I'm middle-aged. Yeah. I'll live to be 104. Well, that'd be awesome.
I think it's a period of time.
Well, it's not.
You're in the middle bit. But it's quite unusual. A lot of people do sketches and then move on to other stuff. So it's, and which you obviously have done. But to come back to sketches as a more mature group of people, the same group of people who did Mr. Show a lot of the time, it's really interesting to see it because they're actually brilliant, the sketches.
Well, thank you. Wait, do you mean that in the British way or the American way?
Really good.
Okay, I mean, the American way, that's a compliment. The British way, that's like, you know, I've had a, you know, an after dinner mint that somebody described as brilliant. So,
because I think sketches are so often just, you know, they're silly. They're something you do when you're 20s, and they're often silly,
sure.
And they're not that thoughtful. But there a lot of these, even though they're quite surreal in... I can't remember which was Bob and David, isn't it? That's the title of the show. They're like little plays as well as being these surreal little twists where they all link together. So they're more about the human condition underneath it all, do you think?
Well, I think that might be a bit grandiose,
yeah.
You know. But I mean, I appreciate it. But I think you're. I mean, we always one of the things that we prided ourselves on was, and I think made our stuff a little distinctive from SNL and all the other stuff that was out there, is that there was kind of a story to be told, and there was some pathos and humanity, even in the dumbest, silliest stuff. There was like we had those moments, but going back to something you said, it was one of the coolest things about regrouping with Bob and David, which was, you know, we were more mature and experienced. We had 15 years under a belt when we came back, and it really cut through a lot of the bullshit that existed when we were younger and we weren't respected yet and we weren't a thing yet and we were still finding our voice and figuring stuff out, and there was competition within the writers, like this unspoken kind of hierarchy, that this inferred hierarchy that didn't really exist, but people would fight to get their stuff on, and there were like jealousies, and now you've got this same group of people together, and they know at this point like that's not how it works, and everybody was very quick, all of us, if a bit wasn't working, and we could, you know, we gave it some time to fix it, but we don't have the luxury of a ton of time, so you fucking figure it out later, lose it, and nobody was precious with their material, and that was a huge difference, and allowed us to just work on the stuff we needed to work on. There was no, you know, we didn't have to like walk on eggshells around somebody because they were upset because their bit didn't get on. We didn't have to sit down and talk to them and explain it. I mean, there's just none of that. We were all adults, and we all, and all those guys have, you know, and a lot of them are successful in their own right now. And so that was a huge difference. And it just allowed us to get in there, have fun, work on it, and, you know, nobody. Yeah. Nobody was precious about anything, you know, and that's a key.
Yeah. Well, it's a game changer, the internet and Netflix as well. I mean, obviously Netflix has been amazingly for both you and Bob, and the Arrested Development went onto Netflix, and they've given you this series. Are you going to do more of the sketch show?
We would love to. It's really all about our schedule, and Bob with Better Call Saul has a very specific, I mean, those are hard dates, and we know what they are. And he has his other projects that he wants to do. In fact, that's why I'm on this tour now, is because we were talking about doing another round in the, you know, 5 months he has off from shooting Saul and promoting it. But he had a movie that he had wanted to do, and I mean, for 10 years he's been trying to do it, and he was able. Netflix gave him the money to do it, and he ended up shooting that well. During the time that he had off, co-starring my wife actually, and they made out.
Wow.
Yeah, yeah. It was weird to.
In the film, right?
No. It was behind the craft services truck, but it was a strange feeling to know that. Oh my God. It's just weird that somebody else is making out with Bob and not me. And I'm like, that's mine. That's mine.
Yeah.
And, well, you know, to each his own.
Right, I'm going to ask you an emergency question. Why do we have frozen peas? My wife asked me the other day.
Okay. Sure.
Why peas and really no other vegetables?
Well, I think the first thing to say is that's silly. There's plenty of frozen vegetables. a cursory look in your frozen food section will tell you.
There are, but I don't think anyone buys those.
Well, of course they buy them because then they wouldn't continue to...
They might be the same ones. They're frozen.
Okay, so following this logic that...
I think someone gave it a go 10 years
ago.
Okay,
do you think
carrots.
That they repackage them as no, the as the packaging it. Becomes modern and because frozen food is has been around since as I don't know why I know this, but a man named Birdseye in the States patented the process of frozen vegetables, and that was in the late 30s. So obviously the packaging is switched as we've gotten modern printing and fonts and all and colors and the way to market things are different. So they take the same contents that have been around since the late 30s, early 40s, and just scissor the bags open, then put them in the new bag and go, we'll just let them hang out here for another 10 years.
Cheaper.
And then when somebody, usually an immigrant who doesn't speak English as a first or second language, comes up and they go to purchase them, the person who's getting minimum wage is paid to go, no, these aren't for sale. You need to put them back.
That's ridiculous. If someone chose them, they would be allowed to buy them, but they don't. Because they have fresh veg. My wife pointed out we have most other vegetables. You'll have fresh in your fridge.
Tell your wife.
Yeah.
Ask your wife.
No, don't have my wife.
Ask your wife.
I don't know that tone of voice about my wife.
You ask your wife when the last time she saw a bunch of fresh peas was.
Why do we have them?
Where? When? Where? Where are the fresh peas? And why doesn't she get them?
You can get them in Marks and Spencers, but they're in a little kind of little bag like that, and then you have to eat them straight away, don't you? Or they're in pods.
Well, I think you have just answered your question of why there are frozen peas, so you can have them and not eat them straight away.
But why only frozen peas?
I think I've done a fair job at destroying that concept. That peas are the only frozen vegetable.
Are you circumcised?
My great 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 cut to 6 months later. Great 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 grandfather Abraham made a pact with God.
Yeah.
All right. These were simpler times. There were not many people on the planet. This is a simpler time. And he made a pact with God who asked him, or kind of demanded it. I wouldn't say he asked him to do this, but that he would cut off the tip of his foreskin. That was something that God came up with. Abraham was not into it at the time, but certainly amenable to it. It's God. And, he had a daily conversation with God. And that was, that was after he, God had told him, hey, sacrifice your son, Isaac, and he was about to do it, and God was like, wait, I was just testing you. And Abraham, went, oh, okay, I was going to say. And then God... And we're directly related. And then God said to Abraham, okay, I appreciate what you were going to do there. Just cut off the tip of your dick. And anyway, that's the long answer to that question.
When you masturbate, is the first stroke away or towards?
Well, you have an iPad. Let's look at the... I've got plenty of... that's how I make a lot of side money, is putting this stuff on. You want to go to... Hang on. I'm going to go to Pornhub, and let me just do this. And then it is category self... C-list celebrity wink. Hang on. Then I gotta go to C. There's David Cassidy. Oh, that was good. And then there's Cross. So let's view it, and looks like a way.
The way.
Yeah.
Turned out to be a good question. That came up in the last show.
And what was the answer? What was the other person's answer? Was it as funny as mine? Was it good? Was it better?
Was it funnier? Yours was better.
Was it mine? Well, mine
really
was better.
Right?
Mine was funnier. Mine was more thoughtful. Thinking about it,
he didn't answer the question. He just asked the question.
Mine was better than
that. Was bad interviewing by me again. I should have gone, answer the question, Marcus. Which is it? Good. Yours was very good. It's the best one. So far to that one, but there's I can't wait to ask Susie Dent next week.
Well, you can just reframe it.
We could, yeah.
You can just say, when
have
you're...
you been female genitally mutilated? And yeah. When you start masturbating on the sexual organs you don't
is
know,
it clockwise,
you no longer...
or clockwise, counterclockwise.
Do you watch Countdown? That's filmed in Leeds, I believe.
No,
okay. That's part of your heritage. You should really watch that.
No, I will. All right, fine.
It's a great. Very excited about meeting Susie Dent. I probably won't be this nervous. Let's face it. So what the fuck is going on in America with all the Donald Trump and the shootings and stuff? What's that about?
I know, if only we could merge those two things.
Who'd have thought this week we'd get a round of applause for suggesting shooting a politician?
Wow.
That's you.
Nice.
Don't come at me, that's you. That's what
good.
You did. That's what you did. Have you learned nothing?
With Trump, a lot of people, I think there's, it gets to that point, and I can't speak for 320 million Americans, but I can speak for a lot of them. I can speak for 300 million of them. There was a point where we started getting... we were getting annoyed. We were getting sick and tired of all these people all around the world going, well, it can't get worse than George W. Bush. And it's a kind of patronizing attitude, and we were like, eh. And then we just heard that forever and ever. And then we were like, you know what? Fuck these motherfuckers. We'll show them that it can get worse than George W. Bush. And so that's where Trump came from. It was us getting tired of really mostly Europe, you know, going, oh, he was terrible. He was the worst. It can't get worse than that. What were you thinking? Like, yeah. Oh, fuck these guys. And then, so that's why we got Trump. And he's in on it. He knows what's going on. Totally in on it.
He's kind of, it's interesting as a comedian with Donald Trump, because he's not, you can't really satirize him. A, because what he's doing is sort of beyond satire in a way, but also he sort of ingests satire like a sort of comedy eating machine and turns it to his strength, doesn't he?
But let's acknowledge that it is absolutely unprecedented. What is happening is unprecedented. There's nothing in the English-speaking world that is remotely, and especially for the most powerful, richest country on earth, that a guy like this could rise to the level that he's risen to. I mean, it's unprecedented. And you know, I was joking, obviously, but making light of, like, George W. Bush. It couldn't be worse. But I think a lot of people thought that, myself included. Yeah. That is the nadir. That's it. That is the bottom. That it could never get worse than that guy. And when you compare the two, I mean, Bush looks like a fucking Rhodes Scholar. He looks like, because part of the knock on Bush was he was simple. He wasn't intellectually curious. He wasn't articulate. And Trump is below that. He's below every category. His verbal skills are terrible. He's a narcissist. He's, and I don't think Bush was. I don't think George Bush ever wanted to become president. For one, I think that was clear from the very beginning. And I think to Trump, it's just an ego thing. Mm. But the other side of it is, how does he get so popular? Is you have to remember that a lot of people don't vote in America. It was a Republican primary, and the rest of the field was pathetic, and there was nobody that was exciting. Nobody had any kind of real, had anything logical or specific to say. It was all pandering to emotional bullshit. It's very much like, there's a direct parallel. I was talking about this tonight at dinner, to what's happening in Britain and the EU referendum. Mm-hmm. I mean, it really has gotten into this, very quickly into this simplistic, nationalistic shit, when nationalism is just a cover for racism. It's racism. That's what nationalism is and has become. It's racist. And it's the same thing in the States. And it's, except there's no veil. There's no, like, we're not couching it in certain terms anymore. And that's the simultaneously the awful thing about Trump, and also the good thing, that we'll look back on this and go, they didn't pretend anymore. They're just being racist, and they're proud of it, and they're appealing, and they don't care that there's a bunch of left-wing, you know, PC people going, "Hey, you're being racist." They don't give a shit anymore, and they've stopped pretending to. And as scary as that is, at least it allows us to address it on that level. We don't have to couch it in, you know, terms. We don't have to say, there are people, like, for me, now I'm really kind of hopping around here, but the term the N-word, the phrase the N-word, I hate. I know I'm in the minority, ironically, on this, but it's such a childish, simplistic thing that I think has done more damage than just, because now you've got people who are racist saying the phrase the N-word. It's like, and the real racists say nigger. That's the word they use. I grew up in Georgia. I lived in Boston for 9 years. People say the word nigger a lot, and they say it with hatred and venom, and they point a finger. And now you've got, you had a several years where those people were kind of, you know, cowed, and now they've come back. And I think it's so shocking, and it's so harsh and awful that we can start having the dialogue again. And I don't know what the fix is. I don't know. I suppose it's generational, and you have to appeal to, I don't think simply putting a bumper sticker on your car saying coexist and we all need to love each other is going to work. And we know that it doesn't work. Otherwise, you know, California would be the United States of America. And I don't know, I've really lost my train of thought here.
It's all good. I just think, I always thought and argued with, like, you know, Hitler, if he'd been in Britain, was that a cheer for Hitler there as well? It's already started.
I think you said I would always argue with Hitler.
Oh yeah, I'd always, and I would always argue, not about everything, but no, it's...
No, he was sartorially, he was a...
We had nice jackets.
Yeah.
But I thought it could never happen in Britain, really. You know, there's always been like that right wing, and there's been fascism in England and the Britain, but I always thought that the humour of the British people would mean if Hitler was there, you know, someone would be going, "Hey, Adolf, you know, eat your fucking shoes, you Charlie Chaplin prick," you know. So they would have, if he turned up with that moustache in Britain, people would have taken the piss out of him, right? And it would never have got anywhere. And that's why he kind of shut down all the cabaret and everything, because he didn't want people mocking him. But I don't think with Trump it matters. Like you say, I don't think the left-wing people saying you've got to say this, that it's like people love the ignorance of the position. They like to laugh in the face of statistics and evidence and say, you know, we don't like experts anymore. We prefer to guess. That's what scares me about it. Is I don't think you can take Trump down with humor.
No, I think he, as long as he, there's a difference between Trump the person and leaving or remaining in the EU as a referendum. Those are two different things. I think Trump as a person, he represents a bunch of people, but he also, he's going to fail because he's a narcissist, and if it gets to the point where nobody's talking about him, then he goes away. He's not a success.
Yeah.
And he's truly narcissistic, and he loves the attention, and he's got enough people now to support him. Who, when he says, "Look, you know, these people are protesting," and it could eventually be 99.99% of the people protesting against him, and he's got 0.01% of people going, "Yeah, we love you, Donald," and that's all he needs to see to keep going, because people are talking about him.
Yeah,
that's all that he cares about, is people talking about him, and but with the referendum, that's you can't personify it, you know. Well, Farage, I guess, but you know, you can't. But even Farage is vastly more intelligent than Donald Trump. He is. You can disagree with him.
Yeah.
But he's more intelligent than Donald Trump. He is. He's
yeah,
more.
Yeah. I think that's true.
Yeah.
Oh well. We're fucked, right? So it's.
I mean, I have a joke that I've been doing. This isn't gonna come out for a couple weeks, right?
It isn't. It's not gonna.
So I have a joke that I've been doing about you know, people have compared Trump. They've compared Trump to Hitler, you know, which I think is just absurd. It's ridiculous. You know, it's just not true. I mean, you know, Hitler was articulate and had well thought out ideas, and it's an insult to Hitler to compare him to Trump.
Do you think he won't win, will he? And Trump
no, he will
win.
Not. He won't for a couple different reasons.
Yeah. But, you know, something could happen. That's why I thought with Farage, just takes, like, a couple of scandals, like a prime minister put his cock in a pig's mouth. And if that all happened on the same week as the election...
Well, that won't happen with the Democratic candidate.
So, look, you've been working with Sean Pye on the Todd Margaret series. How did you meet up with... Because Sean Pye is the guy that I think people will know as... He's
Greg.
From Extras.
Yeah, Greg.
So he's the extra who gets the line in the bill in Extras. The kind of is that right?
Oh, no, yeah, he's Greg.
Yeah,
and, yeah.
So he's the one that Ricky Gervais aspires to. So you've been writing the three series of this show with him.
Yeah.
How did you meet up with?
Well, just to briefly preface it, it was Sean and I did the pilot in the first series, and then we brought in. It was Mark Chappell.
Okay.
So Sean, Mark Chappell, and I for the last two series. I came over here to meet up with potential co-writers, creators, and I met with a lot of great people, some personal heroes of mine, like over a week. I met with somewhere between 15 and 20 people. And some I knew right away, this isn't gonna work. And some were, I just wanna spend, you know, as much time in the presence of this person talking to them because I'm so excited about it and I love their work. And then Sean was literally the last guy, the last day of a long day of meeting people. And I just couldn't sit in that room anymore, and I was like, "Hey, man, is it cool? Can we go to a pub? I just got to get a drink, and you know, can we meet there?" And then it was so unfair to everybody else, but, and we did hit it off right away. I mean, that's not to say that we didn't hit it off, and we're still friends, and you know, I love him, and he's brilliant, but he was lucky in the timing is that he's like, yeah, let's go to the pub. And we just sat in the pub for, I mean, fucking till it was closing, you know, 4 or 5 hours just drinking. And so the other people think weren't accorded that kind of nice. Informal meeting. But yeah, we hit it off right away. And again, just hung out and drank for hours and making each other laugh and stuff.
And was it just Channel 4, right?
It was initially a co-production Channel 4 IFC in the States.
Yeah.
And Channel 4 IFC for the first series, and then Channel 4 dropped out once. It rhymes with cunt. Hunt. What's her name? The lady there who chose not to pick us up.
Okay.
Jane Cunt. No, it's Hunt. I remember her name by remembering. Oh, right, it rhymes with Cunt. It's her last name rhymes with what she is. Okay, so I remember that. That's how I remember her name. So she chose to drop out, and but then IFC came in and rose to the occasion.
So it was just you. What the. Why did you come to the UK? Was it just that there was interest in the UK, you coming over doing stuff, or was that your choice?
No, it was. I was doing 2 weeks at the 100 Club, doing stand up with myself and some friends, and we were at the 100 Club for on Oxford Street. And after a show, these two women came up to me, and by the end of the show, I was drunk, and it was very celebratory, and you know the 100 Club, there's no like ventilation, everybody's crammed in there, and it's just loud and raucous, and they're like, oh, we were wanted to talk to you about doing a show here in the UK, that a comedy show that we do as a co-production, and this is like, hi, yeah, okay, great, and then took their card, and I fucking never talked to them. I did like, okay, great, all right, lady, and then just continued doing shots and hanging out with my friends and all that stuff, and then a couple days later, I remember where I was. I was in a cab to go do this other thing, and then I remember like 2 days later, sitting in that cab, going, "Wait, they asked me about doing a TV show here. That sounds like a good idea. What the fuck are you dismissing it for?" And then I started thinking about it, and then I got back in touch with them, and I met with them, and. That so they approached me about doing a show that could be and I didn't know what that show would be,
right.
And I knew I couldn't do I wasn't competent in doing an English accent all the way through and nailing it, so I knew my character would have to be from the States or Canada, so it put some restrictions on whatever the idea would be, and anyway, yeah
I wasn't asked to come and meet you then. So
oh, you were.
I'll send you some Fist of Fun. I'll send you the Fist of Fun DVD, and I think you might want to rethink. I owe you a lot because you were one of the first people to invest in Kickstarter.
Yeah, I was the first person. Yeah.
So what attracted you to Kickstarter, and how much of my money do you get every time I raise a pound?
It's not a publicly traded company, so Jesus, I wish it was. I'd be a fucking multimillionaire. But they're very vocal about being, you know, I can't remember what it's called, like a green company or something like that.
Yeah.
But we're never going to go public. That's not our thing. Okay. And that's great for them. No, but I my cousin had done a book with Perry Chen, the guy whose idea it was, and said, you know, my friend has a great idea, would you meet with him? And he's looking for investors. And I met this kid, you know, lived in a, you know, apartment with six other roommates in Bed-Stuy in Brooklyn, and had to sign an NDA, which I thought was silly, you know, like a non-disclosure agreement. And we met at some place in the East Village in New York, and had lunch, and he told me the idea, and it's immediately a brilliant idea. I didn't know how it would work. I didn't know the technicality of how you make that work, but it's just a fucking great idea, and it was just stripped of everything else. It's a beautiful, wonderful, great idea, and yeah, I was like, yeah, sure, I'll give you some money, and I gave him some money, and then, yeah, it turned out to be
successful and global, and that's great.
If it was such a good idea, why didn't they kickstart it to start?
Right. Chicken, egg, I got it.
It is a good idea. I'm doing a sketch. It's fucking I'm doing awesome. A sketch show in the autumn that which we funded via, and we do usually do this
it's,
via it as well.
It's so cool. I mean, I distributed my movie through Kickstarter. Right. I screened it at Sundance and then here at Sundance in London, and we weren't happy with the offers we got. They were very kind of standard. It was just going to disappear. So the producers came up with the idea, like, what if we kickstart self-distributing it? And we were able to get it in places it would never go to. And that was all, it would never happen in an era before Kickstarter. So that was cool.
Cool. Well, thank you for helping my career by doing that. You could just give me the money, but it's...
I feel like we're winding down.
Yeah, no, we're, we can do. But
I'm speaking on behalf of the audience here.
No, I think they're fascinated by you.
I'm not saying they're not fascinated. I'm saying let's not overstay our welcome.
We will. Oh, you don't know what this podcast is about.
Should you change the name to overstaying our welcome?
Yeah. If you overstay your welcome, you know this. It starts getting funny again after it starts getting very right. Interesting. They're all anxious about the
guys. Hang on till 3 a.m.
3-0 to Wales. I tell you, the people that listen to this at home are going to be so excited by that. Wait.
So what is it? Wales is winning.
Wales have won. What about England? You don't get that to your phone. Still 0-0.
It must so be. Wales it must be almost done, right?
Must be
the England.
Yeah.
And are they allowed to tie at this point still, or do they have to?
No, football's all it's all about the draws.
I've come to appreciate football on a greater level than before when I didn't know anything about it, and that's true of any sport. The more you know about the minutiae and how it works, the more you appreciate it. But unlike any American sport or top sports, I guess. Football, you can, and this is true, you can watch the first 5 minutes, right? And you're with friends, and you're like, okay, I gotta run out and do some errands, and then I gotta hop in the shower. And you could come back 30 minutes later, and go, what's the score? It's still 0-0. All right. And is there any crazy shit happen? No. Any red cards? Is there a red card or anything? No. Is there like a change in momentum? No. Nothing! Nothing has changed! Nothing! Zero! Nothing!
Yeah.
Was there anything exciting? No. Nothing!
It's a terrible sport, and it's just about luck, really. It's just like, we managed to kick that in. Oh, it went in. Fuck. We've won. Oh. It really genuinely is. It's so stupid. And people take it so seriously, and they go, oh, no, how did England draw against this country? And they don't look at all the other results and go, oh, well, that amazing country lost to that Albania. And that, you know, it's a game where anyone of a certain standard, if you like some, if
well, a professional,
if a professional team went out and played some children, they'd probably win every time. Not definitely. that's how bad a sport. It's not as bad as cricket, though. I mean, our sports are terrible. It's a terrible thing.
But I truly understand, and I've had plenty of foreign friends who've come, and I love baseball. It's my favorite sport, and I've been watching it since I was a kid, and I know it. I know how it's played. I know the stuff that you can read between the lines. You know what's happening that you can't necessarily see, and the decisions that are made constantly. But for my foreign friends who come and watch a baseball game, it's excruciatingly boring. It is, and I get it, because you don't know what's happening, you don't know why, but I get the sense that cricket is kind of like that. Like, if you knew more about cricket and where they're positioning and the wicket thing, no?
I know all about cricket. I used to score cricket. I wasn't very good at cricket, but I used to be the score guy.
Well, I think those two things go hand in hand.
You have to put dots in a box. Six dots in a box, and if it's a run, you put one. It's a terrible, terrible sport.
Could I ask the gentleman for another John Smith's, please?
I'm sure we can get you another drink.
Make me stay here longer.
We won't make you stay much longer.
I'm concerned about my wife.
Now you've... that's nice.
I don't want her to be bored.
You're worried she's making out with someone in the audience.
I just don't want her to be bored. I don't want her phone to die because she's on the internet while I'm doing.
How could she be bored? This is amazing. Are you going to... You've got married. I'm quite tired because I've got a little baby and I'm an old man. Are you thinking of having kids?
Yeah, we've been trying for a while. Yeah. Well, I have. She don't do shit. If I can lay there and yes, we want kids and we've been it's frustrating how you can have kids that you don't want at the time, and then when you want kids, it's difficult to have them. So,
yeah.
Oh, you got me again.
For those at home, he's pointed to the ceiling as if to say to God.
It does feel like it's something that's very easy, and it's not very easy. But sometimes it's very easy.
No, I mean, when you don't want them, you have them, and then when you want them, it's difficult to have them.
But I see. I just like talking to people, and like talking to people with Marcus last week, and with you, your relationship with your dad. As a dad now, I'm kind of this is better.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
If Farage wins, he's on his way home. So that is that's. There'll be no beer. There'll be no he definitely won't win. I mean, they'll know at home again how stupid I sound. But, you know, I'm terrified as a father that you kind of... It's so much responsibility, and then you think, oh, God, you know, what if my kids end up hating me and not wanting to see me for, you know...
Well, there'll be a phase where that'll happen. Yeah. You just hope that phase is in a lifetime.
Yeah.
You know. But yeah, there'll be a point where they're like, well, you know,
I'm pretty cool.
We all went through that, right?
It's
when dad starts saying, I'm pretty cool, that's when usually turns the kids off. How many kids do you have?
I just have one. We got one. So I've left it reasonably late, as you have. Well, you know.
Right. And we all get it, Richard. Yes. We get it. I didn't leave it.
I think it's absolutely brilliant. It's a brilliant thing to happen, but it's just utter terror.
I'm very much looking forward to it, and I truly, it's something that I definitely desire, and I think I'd be good at. I have moments that pop into my head, because my dad was a fucking shitty dad, and a shitty guy, but I do have those moments like, oh my God, are there genetic DNA, nature things in me that are going to be shitty to my kid? Am I going to... My dad had three kids, and basically, you know, at some point we're like, yeah, I thought I'd like kids, but I guess I'm not that into it, and then took off, you know. And I don't want that moment of like, I thought I'd love this kid, but I don't. I don't know what to tell you. Gotta be true to me.
Yeah, I guess, you know, it's so difficult to even contemplate that, because, you know, you're so I say in my show when I start talking about it, but it's kind of a weird thing because you love them to begin with and then you love them more every day, and I've never experienced love going in that direction, because usually it starts big and then just dissipates gradually, day by day, like the air coming out of a balloon until there's literally nothing left. So it's really terrifying to go in the other direction and know how much...
Wow, that's interesting. Yeah. I've never heard it. No, that is interesting.
But so I think it would take something.
But
weird
I love my wife more now than I did when I first met her, and I love her.
If you're going to be honest about it, obviously the joke falls apart. But I love my wife in a different way. Love does go stronger, but it's a terrifying thing to know, and that for them to, it's like the baby knows that they've she's got you. You know, that's the
that's my fear, Richard. Yeah. That's my fear.
So she knows.
Is that I'm gonna sit there and go, you're fucking manipulating me. And I know you know that. And I know that.
Yeah.
And I'm not gonna let you fucking get away with that. And then I turn into my father. Like, well, here, all right, this may be, you know, may take 50 years, but yeah, I'm out of here.
Well, we're just older dads, so we'll just die before that happens. So we'll leave them by dying, which is the cool way to leave.
But science, man.
Yeah.
In the next 25, 30 years from now, science is going to be, we're all going to have VR eyes. Am I right, guys? VR eyes, right? Yeah.
And can I talk to you about drugs?
Sure.
Do you have any good ones on? You know, I... Because I don't take drugs. But you have taken some drugs. My friend Adam Buxton was slightly scared of you. I did a podcast with him and he talked about you.
I like Adam. I haven't seen him in quite a while.
Well, he met you backstage at a gig and you were espousing that a certain drug was really good and he couldn't work out if you were joking or whether you meant it, and it wasn't one of the harder drugs that's quite dangerous. You're going, no, it's not that dangerous, it's fine. And he didn't know if you were joking or not.
No, I wouldn't joke about that.
No.
But I think a lot of if we're having a conversation and somebody's asking me about it, because I remember the first time I took acid, I remember it was a very not an epiphany, but just a realization. And I was so scared to take it. I was really apprehensive and anxious, and all that anxiety and apprehension came from growing up and seeing those films they show you in school, like you drop acid and then a guy looks in the mirror and he sees a devil and then he peels his face off and then he jumps off the building. He's like, I'm Superman, and all those things. Like, oh my God, I don't want that to happen to me. Why would I knowingly ingest this thing that's going to make me slice my eyes out and jump off a building and where I think I'm Superman? And then I took acid for the first time. And I was like, well, that's not remotely like it was at all. I mean, it was a really pleasurable, fun, sometimes, kind of little weird, sketchy moments. But it was, for the most part, it was awesome. And then I started doing more drugs that I had heard for, all throughout my childhood are terrible, awful. And then, obviously, at that point, you're an adult. And you go, I see how this works. And I've really only had one, there's only been one drug that I liked so much that I knew that I could never take it again.
Right.
And I was here, actually, in London. And it was, and I'm not addicted, I don't have an addictive personality. I don't get addicted to things and can stop things whenever I want. I've done heroin plenty of times. Don't want to do it again, not going to do it again. And that's supposedly the most addictive drug, but yeah, there's one that, like, I did it once. It was amazing. It was so amazing. I can never do it again.
Okay. Do you think it's really? Because my just fear is that it would, alter my brain in a way that I wouldn't then recognize myself afterwards again.
Yeah, but that's I don't want to say propaganda, but that is that's all this. There are negative aspects about any drug and positive aspects about any drug that are told to you that are kind of bullshit. They're on the extreme ends. Like, it's not going to open up your mind. You're not going to, write the world's greatest novel because you took some peyote, and you're also not going to kill your babies. Those are two wild extremes. You'll have an interesting experience, and it's never been on either of the extremes, any of my drug experiences, and I've had a bunch, that are like awful, awful, or wonderful, wonderful. Those magic things that, a bunch of hippies on the beach tell you are gonna happen, don't happen. And those things that Christian, people tell you are gonna happen if you smoke pot, don't happen. Hmm.
But people sometimes die from taking drugs, don't they?
Yeah, well, there are some drugs that are, if you go and buy from a certain person, if you get them in a certain way, and again, it's specific to some kind of drugs that are cut with But that's just sensible.
Yeah.
You don't want to go to a some sketchy, weird rave, you know, and a guy is pushing this stuff on you, and that's just stupid. Then you're asking for it. You should... I'm going to give everybody here a number. He's my guy. He's awesome. He's totally trustworthy. His mom's from Jamaica, if that means anything. No, but if... I mean, yeah, there are people that are... You can't get street drugs from a, you know, and expect or not be surprised when something goes wrong.
When I had magic mushrooms once at Glastonbury, and I did see the devil, and he was masturbating a bit of liver. But then I looked again; it was just a guy stroking his girlfriend's arm. It was fine. It was okay. Or was that the hallucination and it really was the devil with the liver? That's the question.
I think it was the devil loves glasses.
Yeah.
He loves liver as well.
Because that's what if dark drugs make something that's really scary and bad look nice?
And then
you walk towards it and then it's the devil and he gets your liver and he masturbates with that.
I guess I wasn't brought up in a religious environment, so I don't, that's never a fear of mine that I would conjure up the devil. That's all based
don't have
on your
to believe
crazy
in him for,
repressed don't, bullshit.
You don't have to believe in him for him to come and get you, do you?
Were you born up in a, born up, were you brought up in a religious?
Well, my parents, were quite, and are quite religious, but yeah, it was, they were Christians, but I mean, not like overbearingly so, and I turned against it when
well,
I was
that's
very
relative.
Young.
But you had, it doesn't matter if you eventually came out of it.
Yeah.
If it's in your brain, it's in your brain.
Yeah.
And if you're going to take mushrooms, that shit can unlock, you know?
I won't do it again.
I
had too many. I thought they were just, like, juiced.
Well, that's also part of the problem. You can't take, like, 9 hits of acid and...
I had loads of them because they were nice. I thought,
no, I did. Nice. I made the dumbest, stupidest mistake. I had a bunch of hash that I had brought back from Amsterdam, and I put it in a coffee grinder, and I made brownies. So a bunch of friends of mine and I were going to go to Vegas. I was like, oh, I'm going to take all this blonde hash I got, this like powerful hash, put it in the grinder, put it in this mix, and make brownies. Without ever once stopping to think about the proportion or any of that. And then, stupidly, it didn't occur till like almost like maybe 30 seconds after the last bite went down where I was like, oh, hang on. And a bunch of us just like tripping balls. It was awful. It was not good. I couldn't speak. I couldn't... And I had to be led around, and it's Vegas too, so it's a mile of like ding 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 ring ding 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 ding, you know, and bright lights, and it's designed to make you to trap you in there, so you can't. And I literally had people had to come and take me by the hand, my friend, and not just me, but other people, and that's stupidity. That's like not understanding how much you're supposed to take. Like with mushrooms, you take this much. This is the how much. You know, how effective it'll be, and so you only want this much. You need to know that before you go into it.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you'll have a bad trip. You'll see the
it was quite nice.
Devil jerking off a... Actually, if a devil was jerking off liver,
yeah.
Is that it? That's not the worst thing in the world. he's preoccupied. He's not going to do anything to you. You just sort of go, oh, sorry,
and
then take your pay back.
It was because I caught his eye. That was the, you know, it's like, I don't know if you've ever caught the eye of someone who's masturbating, even just with their genitals, but with meat. It's just like you catch their eye and it's
I'm sorry.
There's an awkward moment.
If you're out in the field in Glastonbury, then there's no, it's not, oh, I'm so sorry to intrude on your privacy.
Beelzebub. Good. I'll ask you. We'll wrap it up in a sec. You've taken coke in with the president, though, but not directly with him.
No, that was I didn't. That's got blown out of proportion.
I know. I've just done it myself.
Yeah. It was the White House Correspondents' Dinner, which is much different than being in the Oval Office or something like that. But the president was near me, and I just did it as part of an escalation of. bets I made with a friend of mine about, you know, top this. And it started like years ago, like little things. And I knew, and unfortunately it was to me, and you know, I don't give a shit and I don't care, but I was there on the, I was invited through my wife, who has a lot of friends, you know, involved in there, and there were people that invited her, and so it reflected very poorly on her, and we weren't married at the time, and I felt terrible about that, because there is a point, and it was an eye-opening experience, because like I don't give a shit, I've got nothing to lose, I don't give a fuck, but that's not true of everybody else, and so that was a bummer, but. The situation was just, I mean, when I say it was like a pinch of salt, it was nothing. Yeah. You couldn't, it was this much. And it was only about, hey, look what I did. And it wasn't like I fucking chopped up a big fat rail in front of, you know, Scalia. I just put a little bump. I brought it down with me on the train. I put a little bump on my hand. And I just, you know, I like kind of got my wife with my elbow there. And I was like, okay, I need a witness. And then... like that, and that was it. That was honestly it. And then it got way blown out of proportion, you know. Because I ended up, I obviously had a little bit left over, you know, I just brought this little stuff with me, but then Obama had seen me do it. whisper to a Secret Service guy comes down, what is that stuff, where'd you get it from? You know, who's the guy? Is it from Danny? Is it Danny? And then like hand it over. Fuck you, I'm not gonna hand it over. And then it was just awkward because I'm there at a table with like the Secretary of the Housing and Agriculture, and then Jake Tapper, this ABC correspondent. It was really awkward because this guy wanted the Coke to give to Obama, and I was like, no. And that's what really... Yeah. That's where they made me look bad.
Okay. I wonder if I'd taken drugs, whether I'd have done better as a comedian. That's why I think... Do you think it's got a...
No.
Socializing...
No, I don't mean you.
No. Because I couldn't be any better. Because I couldn't be any better.
No, that's not what I meant.
Because I couldn't be any better.
I meant that it's not going to help. If you're
as a social thing, not as a way of making you have crazy, nutty ideas. Because everyone goes to you must be on drugs. Where'd you get your crazy ideas from? From thinking about stuff. But like I, you know, I think that I was always, I didn't go to the parties and stuff because I didn't want to be involved in all that stuff. So don't you think that networking aspect of it?
Oh no, no, No. It's to each his own, and like I don't do well with pot. I smoked weed for a long, long time, lots and lots, and I just had to grow up and go, I don't do well with this. I'm not productive. The shit that I write, the stuff I come up with is garbage, absolute garbage. It's a waste of time. I'm antisocial. I'm already somewhat antisocial. I'm even more antisocial, and I'm prone to anxiety a little bit. And back then I certainly was, and it just makes it worse. And then I had to just say, no, I'm not good with weed, but I can recognize that other people, because we're all made up of chemicals, and when we introduce these other chemicals to our chemicals, we all react differently. I can drink 2, 3, 4 times the amount that other people can drink and still be coherent and conduct myself. And some people can have 3 drinks and just fucking lose it, but they can smoke a pound of weed and they're fine. Yeah. And so it's different for everybody, but I truly don't think you should ever take drugs.
I'm going to do it for next week. Between now and next week, I'm going to take a different drug every day.
That was my secret plan.
And then I'll email you.
I hope you would turn in defiance and go, I'm going to do all this.
I will.
No, I don't think you would. I don't think you would handle it well.
You're right. Yeah.
I think you would just, if nothing else, really annoy the people you were with. with your constant updates about how you were in the situation, what's going on, ask, peppering them questions like, do I feel, am I crazy? Do I look crazy? No, I don't. But you can understand me, right? No, I should never do this again. Or should I? Should, maybe I should do it again. Nah, I won't. No, I should. I should. Definitely be, it's because of that, because I'm asking myself right now. Well, at least I got myself talking. Okay, so that's a good thing.
I'm going to do it for Vic Reeves next week. That would be a podcast.
Okay, so let's wrap it up.
Yeah. I'm imagining your bladder at the moment and just thinking, I wonder how long I can get him to sit there before he wets himself. How's your bladder's control?
It could use an emptying. I'll be honest.
All right, we'll wrap. We'll end on a high with a fantastic emergency question. Is sex with a ghost cheating?
Absolutely not.
No.
Maybe you're asking the wrong person. I think sex with anything, I have sex with corpses, right? And to me, that's not cheating. I have a list, you know. Do they speak English? No? Well, that's not cheating. Like, I have a long list of...
Ghost sex is okay. What about if you had sex with a Bigfoot? Would that be cheating?
It doesn't matter because it would be so... it's almost like one of those monkey paws type of situations because... You would live your life, you'd go crazy because you'd want to tell people, I fucked Bigfoot. But you can't because they wouldn't believe you. And you just look like an idiot. But you know that you fucked Bigfoot. Although technically it's cheating, it's kind of not cheating because no one will ever find out about
it. That's it.
They won't believe you even if you say it.
No.
You know.
It's quite a good person to cheat with when you think about it. You have to cheat with someone.
Oh, no, definitely cheat with Bigfoot.
You know, they say Bigfoot. I've embarrassed and ashamed myself. And I will go and take all the drugs in the world. Ladies and gentlemen, give a big round of applause, David Cross.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. See you next time.
How'd you like them sky potatoes?